Hello and welcome to my list of the best and worst games I played in 2021. Not necessarily games that came out in 2021, just that I played them for the first time in that year. This list is in no particular order, and I will be stating the winner of best or worst at the end of each list. Who will get the coveted Golden RoboCop Award for the best game I played in 2021? And who will get the dreaded Murphy Pendleton Award for worst? Let's go. Best games I played in 2021. Number 1, Loop Hero. How do I even describe this one? It's not really the type of game I would normally enjoy. I'm not really into classic turn-based RPGs, but this was really good. It was recommended by a longtime supporter on my Patreon, and it turned out to be one of the biggest surprises of the year for me. You see that it has a very old-looking art style to it. You set your character's weapons and armor and abilities, and you put them on this looping path where you encounter turn-based fights that are played out automatically. You cycle through the level as many times as you can before you decide to stop, while you're gathering resources that are used to open new areas of this village that can forge new weapons and abilities. It's an addictive and creative twist on the classic RPG formula. I lost entire days to this game. I never actually finished it, but I enjoyed the hell out of it. Number 2, The Messenger. I can't believe I had never heard of this game before. It's fantastic. It's another viewer-recommended game. I think it was actually the guy that recommended Loop Hero. I may be remembering that incorrectly. The Messenger takes the ideas established in Ninja Gaiden from the NES and modernizes them with a variety of new mechanics, RPG elements, exploration, and more. It has a kick-ass soundtrack, and the art style shifts between 8-bit and 16-bit, something I've never seen before. Boss fights are built on learning new mechanics, and there's a strong sense of player accountability through the credit system, without being super punishing like Ninja Gaiden was with its live system. And the story is fun, and at times really funny. It's fast, it's engaging, there's a good sense of progression, and if you're into Metroidvania games, it actually switches genres and goes full-on backtracking exploration. It's a change I didn't enjoy myself, but some people do. Even with the change, the hours leading up to it were very satisfying. If it had continued as a linear adventure, this could have been a strong contender for best of the year. Number 3, Aliens Fireteam Elite. This one is kind of complicated because it's a game with some real flaws. It launched with terrible matchmaking, I'd say the matchmaking still isn't very good, the bots are really dumb, the game is also lacking in mission variety and in the number of missions. On the positive side, it captures the Aliens world very well, spanning the various films, even the Prometheus sequels. A bit too much there, but it's okay. The sound design is spectacular, there's a great variety to the alien types, character classes are well designed, the guns feel great, class-based equipment types are fun and work well with other classes, the modular upgrade system is straightforward and interesting, I like the credit system where you can buy upgrades or buy consumables to use in difficult missions. There's so much I like about this game, and I had a great time working up the difficulty levels while I played with friends online. But the end game of Aliens Fireteam is abysmal. Once your characters are fully leveled up, the intense difficulty becomes a walk in the park, and the next difficulties are an absolute joke. It's way too easy to kill your teammates, making explosive and fire-based weapons nearly unusable, and the enemies become total bullet sponges. And they give you less ammo. Really? Both? It's so boring. When I raise the difficulty in this game, I want to see more aliens. Not the same amount of aliens, but they just take forever to kill. It destroys the immersion too, because when you think of the Aliens movie, you don't think of soldiers emptying 40 rounds into a basic alien before it dies. Aliens Fireteam eventually got to the state where it's unplayable for me, and that sucks because I really like it. Despite the terrible endgame and the matchmaking problems, it still makes my best of the year list because I got a good 40 hours of entertainment out of it before it went sharply downhill. Number 4, Celeste. I'd seen Celeste here and there over the past couple years, and I finally decided to give it a try. Soon after, I made a video about how amazing it is. What else can I say? It's a masterpiece. Probably the best platformer I've ever played. It's beautiful, the music is amazing, the characters are charming, the controls are tight and responsive, the puzzles are unique and challenging and ever-changing, and there's a ton of replay value with the secret challenge levels. I haven't gone back to the game since I beat it, but I think I should. I've had the itch to play it lately. Celeste is an absolute must-play if you're a fan of platformers. Number 5, Alisa. Made by first-time game creator Casper Crows, Alisa is made in homage to the classic 90s survival horror titles. Fixed camera, tank controls, tight resources, limited inventory, puzzle solving, backtracking, exploration, enemy avoidance, key hunting, pre-rendered backgrounds, it's all here, and I'm so happy. There's a few genuine scares to be found, the music is spooky, the voice acting is suitably awkward, and it's even made in some kind of PlayStation 1 graphics engine that runs in 480p, so it looks like crap, which adds to the charm. It's definitely not perfect, the launch was riddled with game-breaking bugs, the aiming controls are horrible, and some of the camera changes are unintuitive and lead to frustrating moments of disorientation. I'm hoping to make a full video on this game soon because it deserves to be played by anyone looking for a return to survival horror. Great job here, Casper. I hope you eventually get a team and make an even better survival horror game. Number 6, Bayonetta. As a long-requested game, I went into Bayonetta really excited. I played it from start to finish, I did a video on what I liked about it and what I didn't. It was kind of an up-and-down experience for me, but the positives outweighed the negatives. It has a fun combo system, the controls are great, and the dodge offset mechanic is one of the coolest mechanics I've ever seen in any game, period. I didn't love Bayonetta enough to stick with it, but I can see how deep it is and that it offers a lot to master for diehard fans. If there were an active health system instead of it refilling after every death, it could have become one of my all-time favorites. Number 7, Devil Daggers. Oh my god, this game is amazing. It's so simple. I don't know what the genre is. It's classified as a first-person shooter, but not really. Just because it's in first person and you are shooting, I don't think that makes it a first person shooter. First person shooter makes you think of Call of Duty, Halo, Doom. I guess it's a first person wave-based shooter. Devil Daggers has a haunting 32-bit graphic style and no music at all, just ambience. A game hasn't made me this uncomfortable since Cry of Fear. You're fighting waves of these creepy creatures as the game gets crazier and crazier. One hit and you're dead. Make it as far as you can. Insanely addictive. This game hurts my hands like no other. Massive recommendation, everyone should play it. Number 8, Superhot VR. I got an Oculus Quest 2 for Resident Evil 4, and I tried the demo for Superhot first. It was an instant purchase. This is a killer app, much like if you had an original Xbox, you had to buy Halo. If you had a Sega Genesis, you had to buy Sonic. If you have a VR console, you have to buy Superhot. One of the most fun games I've ever played in my life. Simple, but deep. It's also the perfect game to introduce people to VR since it's so easy to get the hang of. I put this one on from time to time for a sweaty workout. If I had to make a list of the best games I've ever played, Superhot VR is definitely in there somewhere. Number 9, Resident Evil 4 VR. Despite the bullshit censoring, RE4 VR is a phenomenal achievement. Being inside the world of RE4 is one of the coolest things ever. The guns feel great, the enemy encounters are rebalanced to match your new powers of movement and combat. It's exhilarating. I can only play it for a couple hours at a time because I get tired, but it's an incredible experience. Like Superhot VR, it's a system seller, a must own. And if you're an old fan of RE4, you owe it to yourself to experience this. Number 10, Severed Steel. I'm not ready to talk about this one yet, I'm thinking about doing a video eventually. Just know that it's awesome. Slow-mo, stunt-filled shooter. If what you're seeing on screen looks cool, get it. It's fun. Number 11, Unmetal. I haven't finished this game yet, so maybe it doesn't maintain its quality, but the 7 hours I have played have been great. A loving tribute to the classic NES Metal Gear, Unmetal plays with the tropes of the stealth action genre and brings a lot of fresh new ideas to the table. It bends the genre and even enters parody. There's problem solving, puzzles, action, progression systems, hard saves, boss battles, and a player choice system where you get to choose the obstacles that are in front of you. It's also quite possibly the funniest game I've ever played. There were dozens of moments where I had to pause the game from laughing so hard. Number 12, A Plague Tale: Innocence. This one had been on my radar for a while, and I'm so glad I finally got to pick it up. A lot of people thought I wouldn't like this because it's slow and there's lots of story. I don't mind that stuff. If it's done in a way that works for me, I like it. I thought the characters were interesting, as was the world. The setting and story drew me in. I really didn't mind the slow pace. I think there's a bit too much empty walking around in the first levels, but the game opens up as it goes on, and I thought the mix of stealth and action was really well done. It was nice to have new tools and puzzles to solve as the levels changed, and by the end you have these big areas to get through and multiple solutions. The story lost me by the end, and there's a really crap stealth mission involving the little kid, but overall this game won me over. Can't wait for part 2. And finally, number 13, best game I played in 2021. Can you guess what it is? If you follow my channel more than casually, you definitely know what it is. It's Streets of Rage 4. It came out in 2020, but I first played it in 2021, and it had a major DLC update in 2021 as well. Streets of Rage 4 is near perfection in my eyes. It's one of the all-time greatest. It's old school, but modern. It's classic, but it's fresh. The stages are beautiful, the enemies are varied and intense, the main characters are unique and interesting, and the music rocks, whether it's the new songs or the classic ones. Old sprites from the Genesis games are available as unlockable playable characters that keep their original movesets so they aren't just reskins. There's a robust combo system that plays into health management, great levels of player accountability and incentive for smart, stylish play. There's a motivating progression system of character unlocks, and the new survival mode unlocks alternative attacks for each character. Much like Mortal Kombat 9, I'll be playing this game for the rest of my life. Uh-oh, now we get to the crap. 2021 sucked. It fucking sucked. Barely any games on my best of list are from last year, and there definitely aren't any 2021 AAA games on there. Everyone says Returnal is awesome, but I don't have a PS5 yet. Gotta get one for Ragnarok. I didn't play Metroid Dread because I don't have a Switch. I heard it's great. It was nominated for Game of the Year, but that doesn't mean much to me because some of those nominees are on this list. Starting with number 1, Deathloop. If I made 10 lists of worst features, Deathloop would probably win all of them. Worst design, worst ending, worst performance, worst AI. What makes me so upset with this game is that it comes from Arkane Studios, and they make good stuff. Prey 2017 is one of my favorite games. Deathloop is so offensively mediocre and at times straight up awful that it's embarrassing. The fact that this was given super high to perfect scores by a lot of the industry is mind-boggling. It doesn't make sense. Sometimes there's games that get scores like that and I don't agree with it, but I get it. Like God of War 2018, you guys know I don't like that game, but I totally understand why it gets the praise that it gets. If a bunch of outlets give it a 10 out of 10, I don't agree, but it's understandable from the perspective they're taking. Deathloop getting a 10 out of 10 doesn't make sense from any perspective unless you've been living underground for 40 years and this is the first game you've seen since Battlezone. I really didn't want to finish Deathloop. After 10 hours, I was so ready to hang it up and just make my video already. But people criticize me for not finishing every game I talk about sometimes. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna stick this out to the end because people always give me shit for not finishing games I don't like and still talking about them. So I'll see if it gets better. Nope, it got worse. I regret listening to all of you and I wish I'd just stopped at 10 hours. If you want to know more, I recommend you watch my video on it. I don't even want to talk about it anymore. I couldn't uninstall this one fast enough. Number 2, The Ascent. I feel kind of bad putting this one on the worst list. When I think back on it, the negatives don't really stick with me. I just remember some of the fun shooting. I even recommended picking it up on Game Pass and saying that if you get the game, you'll definitely find some enjoyment. Then I rewatched my video and it all came rushing back. The boring world traversal, the boring enemies, the constant repetition of levels, the boring story and dull mood, the lack of an effect on the world through killing civilians even though the game keeps telling you not to kill them, the terrible confused looter-shooter crap with selling copies of guns for currency, the two-weapon limit and one piece of equipment limit when you can carry dozens, the camera problems, the sameness of the main locations, the headache-inducing bloom effects, the bugs and crashes. Yeah, I remember now, like it was yesterday. There's things I love about The Ascent though, that's why I didn't want to include it. Combat feels really good, the equipment types are cool, and I adore the way the energy system works. We need more isometric twin stick shooters, and I hate that I have to be so negative about this one. It could have been great, it just wasn't. Number 3, Outriders. Are we done with looter shooters yet? Can we just let Destiny and Borderlands exist in their own worlds and leave weapon rarity systems out of the rest of our games? Must we continue to suffer through lazy games where the AI is stupid and there's only like 4 enemy types, and the difficulty is based on how spongy they are and how easy it is to just die out of nowhere? In 2022, can we have games where grass and hair doesn't look like my graphics card is full of mustard? Outriders may not be the worst game I played last year, but it certainly was the most miserable. Hey, but at least I got the speedrun world record.
Yes!
And number 4, worst game I played in 2021, Resident Evil Village. Oh man, Village. Why is this my worst? Deathloop and Outriders are obviously worst games overall, but Village is the one that stayed with me. Like when you bite into a rancid pecan and that sickening flavor just lingers. Village is painfully mediocre and bland in almost every way. Sure, it looks nice, but every game looks nice these days. The guns feel good, sure. There's a few effective horror moments, I'll give it that. But as a game, it's nothing special. And as a Resident Evil game, it's downright offensive. My opinion of this game has only sunk lower and lower since I first talked about it. Like I said in my video, it takes aspects from classic survival horror Resident Evil and action-based Resident Evil 4 and mashes them together in a way that forgets what those games did well. It doesn't have RE4's level of action, or interesting combat encounter design, or the in-the-moment decision-making, and it doesn't have the original's exploration-based maps, or inventory management, or puzzle solving. It doesn't have much of anything. It's just a cinematic adventure where you hold up on the controller and follow the one set path with an occasional monster you gotta shoot. You can hold way too many guns and ammo types, crafting items don't take up inventory space, there's not enough enemy variety for the length of the game, the villains are mostly unremarkable, it even has regenerating health just in case little baby is struggling with the scary bad guys and can't make smart healing decisions, poor little baby. Oh, but it has a super extreme difficulty level if you want to torture yourself, so it's all okay, right? No, the systems of the game should be interesting and present in all difficulties. If you play Resident Evil 1 on easy, you still gotta manage your inventory space, and solve the puzzles, and figure out the map. Having a bullshit extreme difficulty that's impossible to pass without ridiculous amounts of trial and error and planning is not a solution to the game's flawed and empty design. Resident Evil Village gets my worst game of the year because of the damage I think it has done to the series. We just recently recovered from the dark years of RE5 and then RE6 where the series turned into a parody of itself. RE7 brought back the slow-paced mood and classic survival horror mechanics, RE2 remake showed how classic survival horror could be modernized and appealing to a mainstream audience, and then Village comes along and undoes all the goodwill that the series was earning, and says, nope, now Resident Evil is a linear cinematic adventure game with no decision-making or thought required. And it was pretty much universally praised for it. High scores across the board, Game of the Year nominee, even winner at some publications, and lots of Resident Evil fans are apparently very happy with this new direction. All of this is why I'm incredibly worried about the future of the franchise, because it sends a message to Capcom that dumbing down the entire game is an easy way to win praise. I fear for Resident Evil 9. I hope I'm wrong. I want nothing more than to be wrong. I want to play a Resident Evil game and enjoy it. I played the hell out of RE2 Remake, despite the issues I have with it here and there. Its foundation was solid as hell. They proved it could be done and that it could be successful, and then they turned their backs on it. I'm so disappointed, even more than I was after the RE3 Remake, which I was mostly able to just forget. That's it for the best and worst of 2021. I appreciate all you viewers and commenters. Let me know what your personal best and worst are, and I'll see you in the next video.